This lesson is part one of a two-part lesson in which we'll discuss adding map labels to incident maps using dynamic labeling, the National Incident Feature Service label point layer, and annotation. In this part, we'll discuss which map features should have labels and present some guidelines and best practices for how those labels should appear. The objective of this lesson is to review standards and techniques for labeling ICS features on incident map products. Students who complete part one of this lesson will be able to identify which ICS map features require map labels, discuss how to appropriately size and place label text on incident maps, point to a few examples of non-ICS features that might be labeled on incident maps, and finally discuss how a GISS might adjust map labels to make certain features or aspects of a map stand out. According to GeoOps, certain incident features must always be labeled on incident maps. These include assignments such as divisions, branches, and zones, as well as drop points and helispot incident points. If shown on the map, the fire origin should be labeled with date and time of ignition if the information is known. Other incident points that may be labeled, if necessary, include dip sites, fire stations, medical points, helibases, repeaters, staging areas, and unimproved landing areas. These should be labeled with just the name of the point, not the words dip site, helibase, staging area, etc. Map labels for divisions and branches are essential, as line assignments are only identified on incident maps through a combination of symbols and labels. Assignment labels should be placed outside of the incident perimeter and centered between adjacent assignment break labels. The default font size of a division label within the NIFS label point feature is 30 points, but this can be adjusted up or down as needed. Here is a simplified example of label divisions. There is no division line or polygon feature to label, and the division breaks themselves aren't labeled. The assignment area is identified on the map by placing the appropriate map label between the division break symbols. According to GeoOps and the PMS 936 symbology event point table, helispots and drop points are the only two point feature types that must always be labeled. There are currently two methods for labeling drop points and helispots. On feature labeling places the numeric only identifier for the drop point or helispot centered over the map point symbol. Offset labeling is used when a text designator, H for helispot, DP for drop point, precedes the numeric identifier of a label in the label text. The event point layer within the Pro Project Template APRX that's distributed with the incident folder structure is configured to automatically place labels for drop points and helispots using the two methods described above, depending upon what a GISS enters into the label field of drop point and helispot features. If an editor enters a number into the label field of a drop point or a helispot, that feature's label will automatically appear centered over the map feature. If the editor enters a label with a preceding text designator, an H or a DP, that label will automatically appear offset from the feature. The default label properties for labels for incident point features, with the exception of on-feature drop point and helispot labels, is bold 10-point font. This can be adjusted as needed to meet the needs of a particular map audience. If shown, fire origin points should be labeled with the date and time of ignition. When labeled, features such as dip site and staging area should only include an identifying name. Do not include text such as staging area or dip site along with the name of the feature, unless you are instructed by the CITL to do so. In certain circumstances, you may be asked to label incident features not listed as label as necessary in GeoOps. This could include points like camps or mobile weather units. Use the same principles you would for labeling these features as you would incident points requiring labels, and always consult with your CITL when adding labels to these map features. Here's a simplified example of labeled incident points. Notice that the drop points and helispots are labeled with their unique incident identifiers with both offset and on-feature labeling. The fire origin and spot fire are both labeled with date and time. Other things a GISS should consider when creating map labels include: avoid making labels that overlap or obscure other map features, especially important features such as other incident features or structures. Make sure offset incident point labels aren't touching or overlapping their associated points. Consider adding halos to offset point labels to make them more readable over base data. Place division and branch labels in locations that make the assignment areas clear. This can be especially challenging for multi-page maps. And finally, have your fellow GISS and your CIDL review the maps and map features, including labels, for accuracy. The more sets of eyes, the better. This example shows labeled event point feature and assignments, as well as event line and polygon features for context, incorporating the guidelines from GeoOps and some of the other considerations we touched on previously. In many instances, you will be asked to add labeled non-incident features to your map products. For example, you may be asked to add labeled roads to a transportation map, fire history data to an operations map, or mountain peaks with elevations to an air ops map. Follow the same general guidelines for labeling non-incident features as you would for labeling incident features. Avoid obscuring or interfering with incident features and labels when labeling non-incident data. And always seek review and guidance from your fellow GISS and CIDL when labeling non-incident features on a map. Sometimes it may be appropriate to adjust the size of event point and assignment labels to make certain map features more prominent than others. For example, a briefing map is meant to be viewed by a large audience standing some distance away. It may be appropriate to enlarge the division and branch symbols and labels on a briefing map so line assignments are clear even to those standing in the back of the briefing area. Likewise, you may enlarge or increase the size of air ops related points and labels on an air ops map to help a pilot pick them out more easily or make the labels for transportation routes the most important for accessing the incident larger and more prominent than those for the surrounding transportation network on a transportation map. You're going to see a lot of examples of maps on the internet and from other GISSs. So there's things to think about when you review labels on these example maps. As you're reviewing these maps, keep the following questions in mind. Are all the appropriate features on the map labeled? Are there non-incident feature labels that are unnecessary and add clutter to the map? Are the labels well-sized, well-positioned, and clearly visible on the map? Who is the audience for the map and how will it be viewed? Some maps, such as briefing maps, are meant to be viewed from a distance. Other maps, such as IAP maps, will be viewed in hand. Still, other maps may be designed to be viewed on a tablet or smartphone. Are the labels appropriate for the context in which the map will be viewed? Let's review. You should now be able to identify the incident features that require labels on incident maps and which incident features can but may not always be labeled. You should be able to discuss general guidelines and best practices for the placement and sizing of labels on incident maps. And you should be able to name some non-incident features that may be added to and labeled on incident maps. And finally, you should be able to discuss how labels can be adjusted to emphasize certain features on or aspects of a map. This concludes part one of the labeling and annotation lesson. Please proceed to part two.